Great to see everybody here tonight, and thank you very much indeed for inviting me to talk to you about women who stood up to the War Office and who refused to go home and sit still. I feel that some of us just a little while ago were beginning to think maybe we should go home and sit still when we had all our technology problems, and at one point we had pink slides, which was fine because it's a talk about women, but we seem to have ended up with blue ones, so I hope everybody can see them reasonably clearly. So, in October 1923, the title deeds of 3,000 acres of high mountains, including Great Gable, were handed over to the National Trust. These 3,000 acres actually have a direct connection with the Great War, for they had been purchased and donated by members of the Fell and Rock Climbing Club. In memory of those of their members who had lost their lives in that war, which in 1923 was still so very fresh in people's memories. Barely 8 months later, on the 8th of June 1924, the very day when George Mallory and Andrew Irvine were lost on Everest, many members of the club gathered on Great Gable as a plaque was unveiled and a memorial service held for their lost comrades. Countless women attended that inauguration, as the Fell and Rock Climbing Club boasted many female members, many of whom were skilled climbers. And I like to believe that my own grandmother, great-grandmother, was a member of that club because she was actually one of the first women to climb the Mont Brevent, which is what is known as the Ladies Mont Blanc in France. This is a connection here because when she was out of sight of the village, despite being several months pregnant at that point, she tucked her bloomers, her skirt, into her bloomers in order to be able to climb more easily. Hang on to the idea of bloomers. Because in those long-ago days, the women climbed in long skirts. Amongst the women attending that ceremony was a war poet, Helen Hamilton, and she had herself recently scaled Mont Blanc itself. As the names of the dead were solemnly read out, some of those skirted climbers would have thought back to their own war service. Yet, even by 1924, women's part in that great war for civilization was already being very conveniently brushed under the carpet, as would largely remain the case for many decades, perhaps even a century to come. In 2012 to 2013, as the centenary years of the Great War approached and we all limbered up to find ways of remembering, many of my female First World War historian colleagues hoped that at least some commemorations would focus on the crucial contribution women made to victory. Such optimism has largely remained misplaced. And relatively little has been done to promote women's involvement on both the war and the home front. Indeed, there were six fronts on which women were involved. I was very amazed, perhaps I should say horrified, when I was recently contacted by the president of the Western Front Association, an association whose mission, as some of you probably know, is, and I quote, to perpetuate the memory, courage, and comradeship of all, from all sides, on all fronts, on land, at sea, and in the air, and on the home front. He then rather shamefacedly fessed up to, despite having a long list of eminent speakers offering some 600 talks, not even a tenth of these related to women. So I hope that by the end of this evening, you will agree that rich or poor, old or young, their remarkable war service should form part of the mainstream historiography of the First World War and not be put in a neat little patch on its own. When war was declared in 1914, hundreds of women were as ready and as eager to do their bit as the boys who rushed to the recruiting stations, full of naive enthusiasm for the war that was going to be over by Christmas. To the surprise of many of these women, it was made perfectly plain that their services were not required. After all, the war would not be a long one. Refusing to take no for an answer, women used rank, privilege, professional training, and sheer bloody-mindedness to get sent on active service overseas. Whenever I talk about women in the Great War, I always find it very hard to decide who to talk about. But I hope that the women I've chosen to tell you about tonight will be both thought-provoking, interesting, and, at times, entertaining. But before telling you some individual stories, I'd like to just let us think for a few minutes about the sorts of roles that women found themselves in and how this was truly a world rather than a European war. Most people know that, that women were nurses and munition workers, but they were surgeons, they were grave diggers, ambulance drivers, dispatch riders, and in the latter part of the war, they were also auxiliary members of the fighting forces. They served on the Western Front, that almost interminable line of trenches that stretched from the North Sea to the Swiss border. But of course, the Western Front was only one of the six main theatres, and women also served on the now almost forgotten Eastern Front, where they were behind, between, and occasionally even front, in front of our own guns. They witnessed conditions there that made those on the Western Front pale into insignificance. They were taken prisoners of war. They were under threat of execution. They suffered and died during the retreat from Serbia and during the ill-fated Gallipoli campaign. They were on hospital ships within the sound and indeed the range of the Turkish guns. Often the guns on the Gallipoli Peninsula were taking their range on the hospital ships. So the women were in considerable danger at that stage. They also sweltered, froze, and died of disease in Mesopotamia. And in Palestine, they witnessed the collapse of the Ottoman Empire. They went down in torpedoed hospital ships, and military nurses saw active service in East Africa, a very, very forgotten campaign in which the lives of some 300 people were lost, and indeed the trees allegedly dripped with blood 2 days after the firing had ceased. So quite simply, whichever the front, there were women. But that they were there at all was in many cases due both to their own determination or, to put it more bluntly, their sheer bloody-mindedness. One of the very first women to volunteer for overseas service was 47-year-old Millicent, Duchess of Sutherland. She was a redoubtable woman. She spoke fluent French and German, and she was an internationally renowned society hostess. She would put all of these attributes to good purpose during the war. She was married to a much older husband on her 17th birthday, and she had a formidable mother-in-law. Those of you who are familiar with Downton Abbey, think of Countess, the Dowager Countess Violet, and then add quite a lot, and you'll get an idea of what Millie's mother-in-law was like. This provided her with very good training, which enabled her to deal with those who were running the British High Command. And when war broke out, because she had danced with many members of the British War Office, she knew that there was absolutely no point in approaching them if she was to get to the war. An additional 50% discount, no? I'm sure that Millicent would have loved a 50% yes. discount. There we are. For her bloomers, which we're about to hear about. So anyway, she realised that she had to bypass the British channels, and so wearing a uniform that she'd had specially styled for herself by Worth of Paris, she marched down the gangplank of a British steamer and offered her services to the Belgian army. Now, the Belgian army, recognising both a good thing and an attractive woman, they accepted her offer of a hospital unit which was to be funded and commanded by Her Grace, and she very soon began service with the Belgian army. The unit consisted of a male surgeon, 8 female nursing sisters, drugs, and a plentiful supply of glycerine for the hands. She established a makeshift hospital in a convent in Namur. This convent would soon be in direct line of fire of German heavy artillery and would be under constant bombardment. To her relief, our young surgeon, Mr. Morgan, was perfectly calm, and so were our nurses. The same cannot be said for the sisters, the nuns, in other words. They were trapped when Namur was one more Belgian town to fall to the Germans on the 24th of August 1914. Her Grace hastily buried one of her revolvers under an apple tree. She tucked the other one into her bloomers. I don't know if they were also styled by Worth of Paris. And throwing all convention to the wind, she interviewed the newly appointed General Commandant in his bedroom. She used her connections for the first of several times to achieve results. She wrote, "I did not discuss the situation with General von Bello. I simply took him for granted. He said he had met me at Homburg, at the opera. He would get a telegram through to Berlin." As good as his word, he got the telegram through to Berlin, and in mid-September, the imprisoned unit was ordered to Brussels. Von Bello was not able to withstand the daily ducal bombardment. He decided that he would let Colmar von der Goltz, Governor General of Brussels, deal with the woman who had long ago been dubbed by the British Meddlesome Millie. She got that reputation for campaigning to have the lead paint removed from the Staffordshire pottery manufacturers of which her husband was chairman and indeed owner. So the British knew what they were up against, so did the Kaiser. Once she was safely ensconced, at German expense, in the luxurious Astoria Hotel in Brussels, she summoned von Goltz to a meeting. Very much to the consternation of one of her nurses, Florence Ford, she received him in her bedroom suite with her staff flanking her. Florence considered it a very grand hotel. When she told the governor that she wished him to contact the Kaiser and order their release, he eventually decided that the best thing to do was indeed to get rid of the unit as quickly as possible. The Kaiser agreed. I think that they were running up a very sizable hotel bill. He decided it would be much better to send them back to England, where she could be a thorn in the side of the Allies. Eventually, Millicent made her peace with the War Office. And she paused back when she was back in England, long enough to marry her lover of 10 years, and then she went back, this time to France, where she established an ambulance barge and the number 9 Duchess of Sutherland British Red Cross Hospital at Marlow-les-Bains, where her surgeon, Oswald Morgan, became a pioneer in what was known as the Carol Dakin antisepsis wound treatment and saved many hundreds of soldiers' lives. The hospital was frequently under fire as enemy raids took place. However, it took more than a few German bombs to dampen Sutherland's sang-froid. One of the soldiers wrote, "If a raid occurred at night, Millicent would always appear in the wards, a coat over her silk pyjamas and a tin hat on her head. She would joke with the nurses, tell a funny story to the men, and reassure everyone with her own calm and confidence." The words of one of her patients, a private Stanley Woollett, stand for the 5,914 British officers and men who were treated by her unit. He wrote, "It was a place of home-like happiness, of light and flowers." Trying to bring some light to the soldiers and aware of their psychological wounds, Millicent had done everything she could to make her hospital visually attractive. Along with flowers and sunlight, she had also borrowed some of the parasols that were established in the many hospitals nearby in order to give the soldiers something different than the sight of the trenches. Even Maud McCarthy, matron-in-chief of the British Expeditionary Force and initially most definitely not a Millicent fan, acknowledged, "Her little unit is quite beautiful in every respect. Her arrangements are first rate." After the war, Millicent created a benevolent fund. All previous patients could apply for a grant to tide them over the hard times, which of course so many of them faced in the land that was fit for heroes. At almost exactly the same time as Millicent was bombarding the notoriously vicious German military commander, Colmar von der Goltz, another woman was engaged in an identical operation. As resolute as Millicent, she too was determined to stand up to the highest military authority. But she was on the same side as von der Goltz, although he would have been forgiven for at times doubting this. She was a very high-born young German woman, and her name was Elisabeth Schragmüller, although she often went by the sobriquet of Fräulein Doktor. And by the time she confronted von der Goltz, she was an old hand at forcing dominant males into submission. Her story begins in 1908, when despite her own father, and indeed the widespread German prohibition on women entering higher education, she forced the Albert Ludwig Universität in Fribourg and Brisgau to enroll her as a student. An able linguist, she proved so brilliant that not only did she earn the highest bachelor's degree, she became the first German woman in 1913 to earn a doctorate in political economy. She earned it with distinction. This was very far removed from what her very wealthy family expected of their eldest daughter. Indeed, they considered her brains an inconvenience for a female child. Having been awarded her doctorate, she found work as a social worker, which brought her into contact with what she termed the broad strain of the population and with the working class. This increased her knowledge and understanding of human psychology, skills she would soon put to excellent use in the service of her beloved fatherland. When war broke out, cursing fate that she had been a woman and, unlike her brothers, was unable to serve in the German army, she was determined to do her bit. And so, having laid siege to their offices for several days, on the 2nd of 20th August, she succeeded in browbeating the authorities in Berlin into issuing her with a pass which enabled her to make her way without let or hindrance to German-occupied Brussels. I think they wanted to get rid of her. When she left Cologne in August 1914, her sister, who was performing a suitably feminine role as a nurse, begged her to do nothing that might bring the family's reputation into ill repute. Having done her homework as to his whereabouts, once she was in Brussels, Elizabeth took a room in the Astoria and waylaid von der Goltz every day, demanding a job. Finally, as worn down by her as he had been by Millicent, he shunted her off to what he thought was a backwater, with a military office handling mail confiscated from Belgian soldiers. Here, her ability to pick out every vital nugget of information, place this in the bigger picture, and provide military commanders with an accurate picture of troop morale and movements, made the head of the German Intelligence Bureau, one Walter Nicolai, sit up and take notice of her. He sent his protege to the now German-occupied city of Lille in northern France. She was to be trained in military intelligence, and from there she went back to Belgium. Staff raised their eyebrows in fury on learning that she, a mere woman, was to head up the entire anti-French intelligence bureau. Unheard of for a woman to be working alongside members of the German army, she was also placed in charge of the recruitment and training of agents, as well as debriefing them after their missions across the entire Western theatre. That was a pretty huge job. Although by her own confession, like many of her contemporaries, she initially saw spying as something corrupt, which only those of questionable morality and dubious loyalty would undertake, exposure to the real world of espionage and of intelligence gathering led her to know, as it would countless others, to realize that to be successful, both recruiters and spies had to form part of a highly structured, well-organized whole. No detail should be overlooked, and the better trained the agent, the more reliable their information. She set high standards for those whom she recruited. Espionage was a science which could be taught and learnt, not some sort of adventure to be undertaken for cheap thrills and a quick buck. Almost certainly thanks to her brief career in social work, she realised a good spy can be found in unlikely places. She didn't look for intellectuals. She was not even averse to using those who were barely educated. An illiterate florist and a music hall artiste in Marseille proved amongst her most effective agents. They were responsible for sinking thousands of tons of Allied shipping and contributing to France's defeat on the Chemin des Dames. Unsurprisingly, she had a very ruthless streak. She quickly deselected individuals whose aptitudes did not match her exacting standards or who did not demonstrate the level of commitment she expected. She also appears to have had a ruthless approach to sacrificing a lesser spy to protect a more valuable one. I expect some of you have actually heard of the spy Mata Hari, who was executed in October 1917. It is very probable that it was Schragmuller who recruited her, who then hung her out to dry. Sadly, post-war, Fräulein Doktor was herself hung out to dry, but that is a story for another day. A woman who was in her own way as unconventional as Elisabeth Schragmuller, and one whose service ended up breaking all conventional boundaries, was a Suffolk parson's daughter, Flora Sandys. She was 38 when war broke out, and she eventually found herself in the very thick of the action. Initially, her route into war was traditional, via an attempt to enroll as a military nurse. However, the War Office matron who interviewed her and glanced at the Red Cross nursing certificate that she showed assured her that there are plenty of trained professional nurses ready and able to handle all the wounded this war is likely to produce. This resulted in Sandys becoming the only British woman to bear arms in the armed forces of a belligerent nation. She was so enraged that she enjoined a Serb-American Red Cross unit and left England for Serbia on the 12th of August 1914 in the company of a friend who lost both her wallet and her honour during the journey to the Balkans, neither ever to be seen again. By the end of 1914, Sandys had transformed herself into a breeched and top-booted Serbian private and entered onto a new career of hardship and adventure as a private soldier, then as a sergeant in the 2nd Regiment of the 1st Serbian Army. She was severely wounded in 1915, evacuated to a British military field hospital for Serb soldiers, where the British sister in charge refused her admittance. I think she thought the strange NCO was a camp follower who would rise from her bed of suffering to ply her trade. In hospital, she was decorated with Serbia's highest award for gallantry. She was promoted to sergeant major, and she spent many subsequent months in the field, as well as in bars, where she drank her fellow NCOs under the table. She was, however, occasionally disconcerted when she was chatted up by the local tarts, who were unaware that she was female. Peace brought her a Russian husband, a commission in the Serbian army, and, during the Second World War, a confrontation with the Gestapo, and finally, at her family's insistence, a retirement cottage in Suffolk. She had by now long lost her own sense of female identity, and like many male serving soldiers, she never found her way back to Civvy Street. Many years afterwards, she wrote, "Sometimes now, when playing family bridge, the memory of those wild nights comes over me, and I wonder whether it was really myself or only something I dreamed. Suddenly, the scented drawing room fades away into the stone walls of a tiny hut. Now I see myself in a mud-stained, blood-stained khaki breeches and tunic, and my vanity bag becomes a revolver. Then I remember. I am a lady now, not a soldier and a man, and that Serbian soil is resting lightly on the graves of many of my happy comrades I have been seeing in my dreams. Until late November 1956, white hair blowing in the wind, Captain Flora Sandys, gold Cara George Star with swords, twice mentioned in dispatches, zoomed around the Suffolk lanes in a motorised wheelchair, terrorising horses, cattle and pedestrians alike. The woman who in a 1908 competition for horse-drawn stretcher bearers had galloped so fast across the finishing line that she would, according to the judges, have killed her casualty, never lost her taste for speed and adventure. Fluent French speaker Pat Beecham's challenge to the War Office was not so much in going to war, but in being seriously wounded. She was a member of the First Aid Nursing Yeomanry, affectionately dubbed Fannies. These were a pre-war upper-class unit that was formed with the idealistic vision of women riders galloping onto the battlefield to rescue casualties. Initially, they had to supply their own mount on which to gallop. But the war's realities were such that they had to replace their horsemanship skills with superb driving ones, and their ambulances were amongst the best maintained of any in the British Army. They also proved the longest serving of all the female units of the Great War, because they returned to active service during World War II, and many of their female special operations executives, so lauded during the when France was occupied, they were members of the Fannies, and the Corps is actually still in existence today. Beecham herself arrived on the Western Front early in 1915, and her first visit to the Belgian trenches began lightheartedly. She remembers travelling with a rather antagonistic matron who ordered, "You with your French, go into a cafe and ask for the ladies' room." A gleeful Tommy directed her to a nearby brothel, where about 30 or 40 men were being lined up, marshalled in, one by one, by a sergeant major. Our son-in-law is a sergeant major. I often wonder if that's what his duties consist of, but I haven't quite dared ask him. Beecham herself beat a hasty retreat, but she directed matron towards the required comfort stop. However, their laughter was short-lived when they reached the Belgian trenches, she wrote. "I shall never forget that trench. We squelched along a narrow strip of plank with the trenches on one side and a sort of cesspool on the other. Sanitary arrangements seemed non-existent, and I prayed I would not slip. The stench was not pleasant." Serving up the line as a cook, she was awakened early one April morning in 1915 by the sound of firing. She wondered why everyone began to cough and choke. Out of the queer green haze that hung over everything came an unending stream of soldiers, stumbling, staggering, gasping, all a livid green colour. It was the first gas attack. The women offer what meagre assistance they can, and then they return to their post to prepare breakfast. She proudly added, "The men received it not a minute late, just as if no battle had been raging and we had been occupied with no unusual duties." A footnote to the story is that the British authorities, aware of the ineffectiveness of British-issued gas masks and the superiority of the Belgian variety, asked the women to give details of the respirators issued by the Belgians and the chemicals they contained, whether we considered them effective at any distance from gas. I somehow don't think that they revealed to the authorities that they had fashioned relatively efficient gas masks for themselves out of Mr. Southall's hygienic towels for ladies. Beecham continued to serve with the Fannies, glossing over in her writing the loss of both her fiancé and a leg. The former, the fiancé, seem as almost inevitable in her writing, the latter an accident of war. But bitterness becomes visible in the narrative at her treatment in a British hospital where she is considered an inconvenience. Before a visit by the King to the wounded soldiers who were to parade, she was told, "It is quite unnecessary for you to appear." She was confined to watching from a window. However, her mates in the hospital insisted that she parade in her uniform, two rows of foreign medals bedecking her khaki jacket. On this occasion, even His Majesty was unable to stand up to his own War Office. Despite his distress at Beecham boasting no British medals for her actions under fire and her long and selfless service, none was ever forthcoming. Despite her peg leg, she returned to active service, again with the Fannies, in World War II. Staying with accidents that befell women, we all know that many boys lied about their ages to join up. Less well known is that the girls did too. not to join His Majesty's armed forces, but to become members of Lloyd George's Khaki Army, as the women who were employed in munitions works were known. There was a very strict age limit to work in what were known as the danger sheds, where highly explosive materials were handled. A girl had to be at least 18 years old. One would-be munitionette was Mabel Lethbridge. Having told her mother she was going to sew wings for aeroplanes at White City, which sounds quite safe and suitably feminine, nice bit of sewing in there, she actually found herself a job at Number 7 National Filling Factory at Hayes Common. Although the clerk filling in the papers was dubious, she finally accepted that Mabel was 18. Clutching her munitions pass, she was told to report for work the next day. On her way to work on that first morning, Mabel was a little perturbed by the comments of a woman standing next to her in a bus queue. When she heard that Mabel was headed for Number 7 filling factory, she comfortingly told her that she was going to one of them terrible places. 12 months come Christmas, I lost my eldest. A fine girl she was. All blowed to bits. We never got her body home. Underage Mabel had volunteered for the danger sheds, where there were more dangers than the high explosives that the factory manufactured. A fellow worker told her that the machinery they were using to fill shells with amatol had been condemned over a year ago. The replacements had arrived, but nobody had bothered to make them operational. 9 days after Mabel's arrival, the almost inevitable happened. She wrote, "A dull flash, a deafening roar, and I felt myself being hurled through the air, falling down, down into the darkness, a blinding flash, and I felt my body being torn asunder." Darkness, that terrifying darkness, and the agonized cries of the workers pierced my consciousness. She was one of only two of the 35 workers in her shed to be pulled out alive, a very considerable personal risk to the female firefighters who had fought their own way into the blazing building to rescue the women in the shed, and one of them was killed. The other survivor, Mabel's friend Louis, suffered from what is now instantly recognizable as post-traumatic stress disorder. She was taken to what Mabel called a hospital, more suited to the repair of her mental wreckage, where she, like many shell-shocked soldiers, ended her days. The catalogue of Mabel's own injuries was lengthy. Left leg severed, double fracture of the skull, right leg and thigh fractured, both arms fractured, right foot badly broken, left eardrum destroyed, which left her stone deaf in that ear, one lung damaged beyond repair, temporarily blinded by flame, hands badly burned, countless small wounds and injuries, and huge emotional shock. A catalogue of injuries that match, even surpass, those sustained by many soldiers. And she was just 17. Unsurprisingly, there were lasting effects from many of these injuries, one caused by incompetence. Having waited for it for a year, when her wooden peg leg arrived, it had a right foot on it instead of a left, and they wouldn't change the order. On 1st of January 1918, Mabel learnt she had been awarded the OBE for courage and high example shown on the occasion of an explosion during which she lost a leg and sustained severe injuries. She was the youngest person to be so honoured. However, after a hard-fought battle with the authorities, she learned that she was not entitled to a pension. The maximum amount payable under the workman's compensation scheme was £1 a week. She was informed that she was fortunate to obtain compensation, as girls under 18 were not allowed in the danger sheds and she had been working illegally. Struggling to find work and needing to earn her living, she hired a barrel organ, which she played around the West End for queuing theatre crowds. Like Pat Beecham, when the next war broke out, Peggy, as she was now called, due to her peg leg, volunteered for the ambulance service. When ill health caused her to give up that, she established an air raid shelter canteen service. She died in 1968, having figured on This Is Your Life in November 1962. The cause of her death were complications following her 50th operation. At the opposite end of the age scale to Mabel was a mother superior, French-born but now long-time New Zealand resident, Suzanne Aubert. She was born in 1835, and she had, as a very young woman, nursed soldiers from the Crimea, and she had a medal to prove it. One of her very few personal possessions, on one of which she was justifiably proud. Her confrontation with authority was with the Pope, his archbishops, and his cardinals. She founded her own religious order in New Zealand in the 1870s. In 1913, the Holy Father wished this order to be placed under the jurisdiction of the Bishop of Auckland, with whom Aubert had fallen out spectacularly. Her views of religion were that the way to God was through work, preferably with society's most total outcasts. The bishop prioritised prayer, knowing that with the bishop in charge there would be a lot less compassion and a lot more prayer. Aubert decided to overlook her age and her tendency to debilitating seasickness. Now nearly 80, she decided she would go from New Zealand to Rome and make her case to the Holy Father in person. When she arrived, he was too busy to see her. So she said, "Never mind, I'll wait until he is available." Wait she did, until 1918. She found plenty to occupy her in wartime Italy. An earthquake hit Rome, and the sorely depleted civilian medical services were totally unable to cope. She pinned her Crimea nursing medal to her breast, and she began her second nursing career. She describes, "The stolid eyes from shock, rats gnawing to stumps, the hands and feet of people trapped under rubble, flesh minced with bones, gravel, cement, and dirt." The 81-year-old nun worked from 6 in the morning to 8 in the evening, running, in her own words, as quickly as the young nurses. Not only was she battling against war wounds, sickness, poverty, she was forced on a nearly daily basis to confront the misogyny of high-ranking Catholic clergy who felt that her activities were certainly not suitable to a nun. She should just pray for the suffering. Yet she never lost her compassion for suffering humanity, nor her faith in her power to do good. She outlived the first pope. The second one, Pope Benedict XV, finally condescended to see her in August 1918, although the Vatican authorities turned their noses up at her patched, filthy, and blood-spattered habit. Her explanation: she had only brought two habits with her, as she had not anticipated quite so long a stay, nor what she would be doing to fill her time, fell on very deaf cardinal ears. Nevertheless, perhaps rather keen to get rid of this rather smelly elderly nun, Pope Benedict granted her wish. She would remain head of her order, the Sisters of Compassion. When she died, finally, in New Zealand in October 1926, her state funeral was the largest ever awarded to a woman. A footnote to her story is that the lengthy process, which will hopefully lead to her beatification and then her canonization, was placed before the Vatican in 2010. Formalities taking even longer to complete than the First World War, the process is still ongoing, but optimism in New Zealand remains high that she will be their first almost homegrown saint. In January 2016, the first hurdle on that long road to canonization was cleared. Pope Francis declared her to be the Venerable, which means that she is a sort of saint in waiting. And as you know, she is very good at waiting. So, having seen some volunteers, let's have a look at the professionals. Because by 1914, a number of British women were qualified doctors and even surgeons. Some, as we shall see, stood up to their own war office to get to the war. Others, like Dr. Alice Hutchison, fell foul of enemy authority. But the ensuing battle of Will, the last laugh was on the little general, as 4'11" Alice, a veteran of the Balkan Wars, was known by those who worked under her on the Balkan front. In the autumn of 1915, Alice was, like many British women serving in Serbia when Austro-German forces overran the country. She and her all-female staff of 31 women gathered up as much of their donated medical equipment as they could. But rather than join one of the many columns that was retreating over the Serbian mountains in an attempt to reach Albania, the women chose to remain with their patients, and they risked becoming prisoners of war. But they thought that as medical personnel, their imprisonment forbidden under the terms of the Geneva Convention, they thought their release would be a quick formality. How wrong they were. By early November 1915, the 31 women under Alice's command were being held in Hungary as what she calls common military prisoners of war. Most of their luggage and their military supplies, or their medical supplies, had been confiscated. But Alice demanded an itemized receipt for these. She was determined that she would check every single last bandage off when it was returned to her. They did, however, smuggle a precious possession into captivity with them, the Union Jack. To protect this, she did a little superficial undressing. I wrapped it proudly round my body and I redressed. The flag became their talisman, and they dreamed of waving it tauntingly in our captors' faces when released. The word if did not figure in her vocabulary. In the meantime, Alice, who was considered diminutive and pretty, with flaming gold hair and always gaily and fashionably dressed, used a little of her fashion sense in an unusual way. She was a fluent German speaker. She was often summoned to the prison chief's office for long and frequently acrimonious interviews, ever bewailing the fact that although she herself knew it, inside out, the Austrians do not seem to have even heard of the Geneva Convention. Wrapped in the flag, she endeavoured to remedy this gap in their knowledge whilst taking great joy in the knowledge that the broad blue and red stripes stood out beautifully under the thin muslin blouse I wore at the time. This, in the words of the ultra-patriotic British Journal of Nursing, who reported on their activities, was a lesson in patriotism and resourcefulness, of which all her compatriots may well be proud. I hope you feel proud. Resourcefulness as well as patriotism was required. She had an innate understanding of physical and mental well-being, and she preferred those under her command to actively fill their long hours of captivity. And so, in the morning, they had a compulsory German lesson, followed by honing forgotten prowess at rounders and other games in the back exercise yard. Then a scanty lunch of soup from a bucket was followed by a daily walk with two Austrian guards. These soldiers proved inept. Despite the women, quote, only walking about 6 or 8 miles, the guards threatened to mutiny. They claimed that far from walking, we flew like geese over the mud. The afternoon hike over, personal hygiene followed. An arras, we believe wrote one diarist in keeping up a certain glamour, is erected near the stove, and from 5 o'clock onwards, we wash in rotation. The local townsmen were so impressed by the women's cleanliness that they expressed a desire for English wives. Needless to say, the unit regarded that point otherwise. Charades were followed by singing the national anthem, Sotto Voce, which cheered us up wonderfully, and then to bed on, in the British Journals of Nursing's words, straw, no beds or bedding. The cubic space of their sleeping room for 32 women was equivalent to that of a workroom for 9 people under British factory laws. I think that despite their ultra-cramped conditions, they probably slept the sleep of the exhausted. Aware that Christmas spent with no sign of their release would put additional strains on her staff, Alice tackled the prison commander, demanding their scanty rations include some festive fare. Thinking that this time the last laugh would be on him, he agreed. A live goose was delivered to their compound. Perhaps he had momentarily forgotten that Alice was a surgeon. She calmly demanded a knife, killed the goose, and she and the others set about plucking, roasting, and in the words of one of the staff, enjoying a jolly good feast. Eventually, with freedom promised, she determined to smuggle out not only the flag, but also her diary, which she knew, if it was detected, would compromise their chances of repatriation. So she sewed the loose pages into a dilapidated-looking feather cushion, using some of the feathers from the goose, and using her small stature to her advantage, as the women queued up in front of the prison officials to be cleared for release, she simply stood on the cushion, which she subsequently stuffed into her kit bag. Back in England, she hoped that the information she passed on to the military authorities about the area surrounding their camp might one day lead to the successful bombing of it by the Allies. This, she felt, would be a suitable revenge for their captors' disrespect of the Geneva Convention, which, as she frequently reminded them, forbids the making prisoners of hospital personnel. Another truly remarkable female doctor was 50-year-old Scotswoman Dr. Elsie Ingalls. To her amazement, her offer made in August 1914 to the Edinburgh representative of the Royal Army Medical Corps to serve as an army doctor was condescendingly rejected. "My dear woman, go home and sit still." Undaunted, she proposed to a Scottish suffragist meeting that Scottish suffragists offer an equipped and staffed wholly by women medical unit to be known as the Scottish Women's Hospital Unit, and they will offer it to Britain's allies. This suggestion shaped the next 3 years of her life as public speaker, fundraiser, surgeon on active service overseas, and commandant of several hundred women whose professional skills, talents, backgrounds, and idiosyncrasies were as varied as the women themselves. A belief in women's ability to get things done united them. All were unwilling to go home and sit still. Like their brothers in arms, some of the Scottish women were fearless. Others showed their fear, some became shell-shocked, and a number died because of their service. They got on each other's nerves and developed personal antagonisms and vendettas, as well as lifelong friendships and, occasionally, lesbian relationships. Some were flirtatious, others, like Elsie herself, were prudes. As an added bonus, many were copious letter writers, diarists, and autobiographers. They reveal their hopes, fears, and frustrations, as well as the day-to-day humour and horror of their lives. They served on many fronts, but their service on the Eastern and Russian fronts was the most remarkable. The female ambulance drivers set off across shell-crated terrain to bring in the wounded. The doctors performed intricate surgery, and the upper-class young ladies cleaned out cesspits with a will. They made soup with untreated water from the Danube, commenting that it made a lovely-looking, rich, brown broth. Silence reigns about its taste. They went off alone across hundreds of miles of war-torn country to brave the perils of crowded troop trains and desperate peasantry. And they feared the continuous possibility of enemy fire. They were imprisoned rather than abandon those in their care to the incoming enemy, and they placed their own lives at risk through their actions. Ingalls' own boundless belief in the ability of British womanhood to perform the impossible was contagious, as relative newcomer to the unit, Elsie Butler discovered. She was initially the committee that recruited her were rather doubtful about her use, but remembering that she was a fluent Russian speaker, they decided that maybe she could be useful to the unit, and so she was made to understand that to fail Dr. Ingalls in the slightest particular was tantamount to treason. She and four other women set off into now revolutionary Russia. Butler later remembered that three of her four charges were no-hopers. The first was lanky-haired and limp. The second was almost a nymphomaniac. And the third was incompetent, raddled, and rouged. When they arrived in St. Petersburg, the Russian Red Cross commissioner tried to prevent them from leaving Odessa on the one troop train a week. He was convinced we should certainly be raped and probably murdered. The only thing to do was to go straight back home. However, once he remembered the renowned Ingalls' wrath, should he prevent the women from reaching the unit, he crumpled up, being obviously far more frightened of what the Scottish doctor would say to him than anything the Russians could do to the women. Elsie writes, happily, at no point was our virtue endangered. Rape and murder were far from the soldiers' thoughts, but the journey proved grueling. Practically in a coma and crawling with lice, we were an integral part of the Russian army when 10 days later the train steamed into Odessa. Very quickly promoted from bedpan orderly to stores, Butler relished her service and the women's camaraderie. But as the turmoil of the Russian Revolution closed in, War Office officials, uncomfortably aware that there were several MPs' daughters serving with the Ingalls unit, decided to recall them. Remembering at the very last moment that as they had initially rejected her offers of service and they consequently had no jurisdiction at all over Ingalls or those under her command, the officials opted for asking them very nicely to return. Ingalls, a mere doctor in a field hospital and a female one at that, had a final shot to fire at the British War Office. This time, she intended to use her influence to sort out the fate of the Serb army, which was being massacred on the Russian front. She struck a bargain with the War Office. The unit and the MP's daughters would only return if the Serbs were also evacuated and sent to the Serb front. The War Office pulled every available diplomatic and military string, and in late October 1917, the unit began a race of well over 1,000 miles against time, the weather, and the Russian Revolution. They arrived at Archangel on the 9th of November, days before ice closed the port for months. Of course, now it was in total chaos. A national general strike had been declared by Trotsky and the Bolsheviks, with all work of any kind being prohibited, under the threat of dire penalties to scabs. Elsie Butler was detailed by Elsie Ingalls to ensure that their 40 tons of donated equipment was safely loaded aboard their ship to be transported back home. Butler reported the political situation to her chief, only to be told by Elsie Ingalls, "You either get the equipment on board before we sail, or you stay behind to guard it. Your duty is to the equipment." Caught, as she herself expressed it, between the irresistible force of Ingalls' will and the immovable obstacle of a revolution-inspired national strike, Butler wondered whether it would be easier to break the strike or change Ingalls' mind. You probably won't be surprised to hear that she settled for breaking the strike. And within 24 hours, every last item of equipment, all 40 tons of it, was loaded on board. Butler adds a footnote to this episode. "I held up the Russian Revolution for 24 hours in the process." Now the women had to face the rigors of a journey over the Arctic Ocean. 4 days after leaving Archangel, the women's transport became separated from their convoy. Their captain was unable to pinpoint their whereabouts to within 100 miles, one woman wrote in her diary. "I nearly went mad in the night. I am not a coward, really, but this continual strain is terrible." Another, however, felt more confident, secure in the knowledge that one of the unit's members was a Titanic survivor. She had surely proven that she was not marked out for a watery grave. Many of these women had been away on the Eastern Front for over 2 years. They had been close to or in the firing line. They had withstood the horrors of retreat and advance. They had even disinfected typhus-riddled Serbia until it was said to reek of formaldehyde. They had covered hundreds of miles in troop trains, ox carts, rickety ambulances, and on foot. They had tended mutilated bodies, nursed the dying, and buried the dead, their own included, and travelled through a country torn apart by revolution. Many believed that it was only Ingalls' extraordinary willpower which brought them safely through the fury of Arctic storms and the ever-present danger of submarines. The ship's captain earned a decoration for his seamanship. The women earned nothing from Britain for their 3 years of service. On the 25th of November 1917, the Scottish women of the Russia unit sailed up the Tyne. In uniform and wearing her many Russian and Serb decorations, Dr. Elsie Ingall stood on deck to take the salute of the 13,000 Serb soldiers she had helped to rescue from Russia in defiance of Trotsky and the Bolsheviks. Barely 24 hours later, she was dead. In Salonika, the Serbs she had saved would be drafted into the remnants of the 1st Serb Army, with whom Sergeant Major Sandys was now serving. They would fight their way back to their homeland, their breakthrough leading to the speedy collapse of Bulgaria, one of the key factors in persuading the German High Command to sue for peace. When the news of Elsie's death broke, Queen Mary wrote a letter of condolence to Ingall's sister. Dignitaries wrote letters to the Times. Journalists rushed to publish obituaries, leading articles and assessments of her life. The Daily Sketch thundered, "Why not VCs for women?" At Ingall's military funeral, British and Serb royalty were represented, but the mourner who would have given her the most satisfaction was the representative from the War Office. Newspaper photographers fought to gain the best shots as a small coffin placed on a gun carriage and covered by the Union flag began the final journey to the Dean Cemetery, burial ground of Scotland's heroes. Dr. Elsie Ingalls, with her never flagging belief, proved that in war, as well as in peace, women could do whatever needed to be done. So, what does this small selection of stories from the many I have accumulated tell us about women at war? Certainly, the women we have heard about, the service and the fragments of writings I have used barely scratch the tip of the women's war iceberg. But even so, the record is incomplete, because the majority of women did not commit their overseas experiences to paper. Thousands of British women responded to the call to duty, many initially standing up to the War Office to reach the field of operations. And, let us not forget, well over 1,000 uniformed women made, in the language of the day, the ultimate sacrifice. Their grave markers, identical to those which mark the final resting place of service men, can be found in war cemeteries around the world, from Australia to Zimbabwe. The names of those who have no known grave are inscribed on the magnificent memorials to the missing across the globe, and their names are carved on pride on the memorials in Britain's towns and villages, one even up the road in Rittle. Women fulfilled crucial support roles in the war zones, in the auxiliary armed services, the Red Cross, and the vast number of professional and volunteer services which were developed largely through women's own initiative. Their collective actions show just how misguided it can be to order a woman to go home and sit still. Above all, they forced the War Office to recognise that amidst the horrors of war, females could perform, in Elsie Butler's words, every hour of the day, some vitally necessary task when their nation was at war. Their service, their written and their oral testimonies prove that this war, like every other one, before and since, had everything to do with women. Thank you.